playbook. Put in the kitchen, cause your hand them no look your better cook. Think you do your pay your pretty look your wall. If a restaurant and some done man bank book. Cook, eh, recipe book.
Welcome to Dean Unchained, the number one solo cast on YouTube right now. I'm your host, E, aka Venom, aka Mr. Tell It Like It Is. Do you know how I would do it, obviously. But secondly, as per usual on the show, we discuss the battles of mating in the West and, like, you know, the usual struggle in the dating market. All right, let's get it. Right, so today's topic of discussion is mainly about, I know my guys are gonna hate me on this because this whole podcast is centered around a male's perspective on the current dating scene, right? So, how do I say this without sounding like I'm coming at the guys? Right, I'll tell you how fathers fail their daughters, okay? And just try and take it back to the inception, because I know everyone or all the main red pill content right now on the internet, on YouTube, wherever you're subscribed at, is talking about, oh, how women are not cooperative, etc., etc., how they want to adhere to a certain type of lifestyle, and they're all aiming for the 10% of men that make a certain amount of money, etc., etc. But I just want to take it back to the heathen days, do you know what I mean? I'm not talking about Adam and Eve days, but just want to take it back to the inception where a woman is brought up and how essentially having a good father plays a very, very important role in how you, in how she then grows up, selects a mate, and knows how to select a good value man. I wouldn't say a good value, a man with good values and good morals, etc., etc., and how she gets this man vetted by the male figures in her family, or you know, or her father, like a male figure for those who don't have fathers, etc., etc. So let's just take it back there, right? Part of my big goals, right? So. Okay, let's look at this. The male or men, like we are leaders, okay? And this is not even me throwing myself flowers or blowing out a trumpet, but we are leaders, right? And every leader's responsibility is that the people whom he's leading make the right choices and right decisions. So he's responsible for the group. The leader is responsible for the group. And I feel that our father's generation or their father's generation were sort of relaxed in that aspect where they fulfilled their role as leaders, but there was some things were overlooked. Some things were overlooked, especially when it comes to bringing up daughters. Especially when it comes to bringing up daughters, because fathers tend to be less involved in the child hearing and upbringing of their daughters. I'm not saying, again, because people can come at me with this blanket statement, I'm not saying all fathers, I'm saying most fathers, right? And some of the typical things we hear is, for example, a father's not participating in quote-unquote changing nappies, quote-unquote, oh, she's on her menstrual cycles, etc. You don't want to hear about that, that's a father. Some fathers don't want to hear about that, etc., etc. But that's most cases, right? And some fathers, oh no, I don't want to status until they get to an age of marriage, etc., etc., where in reality, I mean, I'll say your daughter shouldn't date. She should find a mate, vet him and get to know him, etc., etc., then of course jet off and get married with him. That's just my perspective on that. Right, so taking back to Inception, like I was saying, the father's failing their daughters is that as a father, right, the things, or as a father, the leader of the house, etc., etc., the things that you need to take care of is essentially ensuring that everyone within your home is brought up to a certain standard. Everyone within your home is brought up to a certain standard. Well, of course, that is if everyone plays their role within the house, meaning the wife is a mother, she's feminine, beautiful, inspirational, etc., etc., and obviously the father, masculine, leadership, decisive, assertive, and whatnot. Strong provider and everything else, right? So that's one of the things. And the children are compliant, they follow, they listen, etc., etc. They don't have any other authority in their lives apart from the father and mother. So what the father would have, what most fathers will have to do, or those who are fathers of age, you know, those who are coming of age or just entering fatherhood, what they will have to do and understand clearly is that their view of their of women, their views of daughters, etc., should not be skewed in the sense that no, she's weak, she's my princess, she's my this, she's my dad, and I have to protect her, I have to overshield her. But rather, they should expose her just the same way they expose their male children. They should expose her to the world. Expose her to the world, like the way of things, the how things work, etc. The difficulties of it. So she sees the difficulties of it. She sees how people, you know, the struggles to be an earner, because that essentially ingrained something in her. Do you know what I mean? It helps her appreciate life. It helps her appreciate the average man. It helps her appreciate a man who provides, an earner, a man who strives for his family, rather than shielding them, and then they have this whole, I'll say this whole cinematic experience at home, cinematic luxurious experience at home where they don't have to do much, okay? So you're the breadwinner, I'm bringing the bread, etc., etc. The bakery, dress fancy, go out, turn up, right? And now they have Disney and reality TV and Instagram and, you know, a whole bunch of social media-ish that's teaching them that, oh no, girl, you deserve this, you deserve that. You need to have your standards up there. You need to, you know, you can get the bag too. You can do this, you can do that. You should aspire for this sort of man, sort of guy. When in reality, that is detrimental to her future life. That is detrimental to her future life. That is detrimental to her mating life and her finding a suitable partner and everything else. That is actually very detrimental, because then her sole focus is on finding a man who is highly equipped to provide. shield her from where she does not get to know, right? And I say, as a father, and as a man, as a leader, etc., etc., you need, or we need, to take full accountability and responsibility for how our women are catered, brought up, and what moral stance they are upon. Because if they're on a certain irrational moral stance, then the society would be great because of that. And there's one very important quote which I, you know, I've come across and I love it. It says a society cannot rise higher than the moral position of its women. This quote was actually a correction from a book of the Nation of Islam, where he said a society does not rise higher than the position of women. It's like, no, society does not rise higher than the moral position of women. And I mean, we all see it right now, where we are right now. It's a crazy crisis. It's literally a crazy crisis because men in the West are no longer incentivized to get married, are no longer incentivized to honor and respect, because that's what marriage is, honor and respect women. Men in the West are no longer incentivized to honor and respect women. They say, no, the woman has been sexually liberated. The woman is, quote unquote, savagely feminist, and she's quote unquote savagely feminist, quote unquote has sexual liberation. So you would find that most women get used and tossed to the side, and you know, and on to next, and on to next, and on to next. And what that creates is a pool. It's a pool of women that have been ran through by a, you know, by a bunch of guys. And when this bunch of men or other men want to then decide to get married, they, right, seriously, the marriage is too high on these women. The marriage is too high on these women. And most of them end up single. Most of them end up to be single mothers on top of that. And they, you know, they bring up children in that sort of environment where they, I don't know, they're sort of disadvantaged. They're just brought up disadvantaged into a society that's highly competitive. And most of the violent crimes, the serial killers, etc., etc., the rape, the rapist, we're not going to use, obviously, I'm trying to censor the word there, but most of those things, or most of those people that commit the worst atrocities in the society that we live in, are committed by individuals that come from those sorts of homes, where the nuclear family has been broken and they've been forced to sort of fend for themselves. I say it's time for the men to take leadership. It's time for the men to reinvent themselves. And I've got sort of five great steps which I generally like to suggest, you know, to my mates, that I take upon myself to practice that in my life. Is that, first off, a man, top priority, his top priority is that he needs to be educated. And if you look at the universities for which, and the primary reason why universities here is because we all believe that you get a fair or decent amount of education when you go to university, okay? But But bear in mind, I'd not say that's the only way to get yourself educated, because there's tons of self-studies book that you can take, read. You know, you could get a collection of books, read upon, and what is economics, culture, etiquette, etc., etc. So a man needs to be well versed in his surrounding. So he needs to educate himself, learn a discipline, make sure you are disciplined, right? Educate yourself, learn some form of martial arts or routine that you go to the gym or MMA, etc., etc. And then the next point is a man, we all need to implement a slight consciousness, or should I say awareness, like God, an awareness of God within our lives. Because a man that leads a woman or disciplines her, leads a woman essentially, or leads a family, is that, okay, you are leading a family. But oftentimes you have the woman question, then, if my husband thinks he's absolutely right on everything, who disciplines him? Where does he, you know, where does it stop? Where can I say no? Where can I say, what can I go and bring to him and say, hey husband, this is something I've come across, etc., etc. I don't care what belief system you're there to, but find a belief system that you're there to, and you know, and follow. Now three, or should I say four, is men, us as men, and I particularly take my ethnicity, us as black men, we need to start to network with one another. Network and communicate with other men. Network and communicate with other men. Oftentimes you'll not see it in this society because the life is so fast-paced, for one, and there's a lot of individualism because everyone just thinks about their self-interest. Everyone just thinks about me, more for me. How can I get more for me? How can I get more for me? And I'd like to make a strong point. This is where a lot of people mess up and they miss out on things because people fail to understand that by helping someone, you actually help yourself. And there's a whole study that's been done on that. It's actually called reciprocity. By helping someone, you actually help yourself. And you wouldn't find this in religious texts or secular knowledge, or as I've mentioned previously, called reciprocity. You help someone, and then you in turn will be helped. So communication is key. It's key for men to communicate and network with other men. I'm not talking just for parties or just for entertainment, amusement, etc., etc. No, because we then will all have that. And that is all fruitless, essentially. Okay? That's all fruitless, makes you go bankrupt. Or, you know, for those that don't have enough, for those that are well off, of course that's nothing. Okay, so that's one. So communication with other men, men expressing themselves to other men about set vulnerabilities or struggles that they're going through, they're facing, etc., etc. So men helping one another. And there's one particular reason why I say men going to men and not going to their partner. And the reason for that is because we learn we love our partners, right? Our wives, mothers, etc., etc. Scratch that. We love our women, right? We love our women, but there is one thing that is a massive turn up for women. Women, they nag, they complain a lot. And a turn off in a man to a woman is a man that complains in action. Because that's what women do. So they complain to us and we take action. Okay, I'll say that again, right? So if you're a man and you're complaining to your partner, to your girl, to your wife, whatever you want to call it, right? If you're always complaining to her, she start to emasculate you. That's for one, and she will start to lose respect for you. So what essentially you need to do is, instead of taking your whole sorrows to her, your financial problems, your problems that she can't help with, essentially. Your problems that she can't help with. You can take those problems away from her and actually express them to a bunch of men within your circle, of course, that are trusted, to be trusted. And then you can both find a solution. Because the man, your man, your friend is going to pose a solution and say, hey, this is what I think we need to do, right? Then you're going to find a solution. Go to your partners with set problems such as, oh yeah, babe, my back hurts. Then she'll be like, oh, you want a massage? You know, then she'll massage. She won't think, oh my God, he's nagging, he's beat this, etc. But if you come to her with problems that she cannot solve, she's going to think, oh gosh, what kind of guy am I dating? Or what kind of guy am I with? And the respect starts to fade. So fathers need to start taking these rules of discipline upon themselves and be involved, like get involved in their daughter's life. Because if they're not, then they're leaving her to her own device. And I hate to say this, but women left to their own device are prone to self-destruct. Women left to their own device are prone to self-destruct. The father just needs to be there as a shepherd. Yes, she's free to make her own choices, but as her shepherd, as her father, you are there to advise her on those choices. Or just as a man, let's say it's a home, right? Let's say it's a home, for example. You don't have a father. The father's passed away, right? The father who grew up with you guys passed away, but there's a son in the family. And he's old enough to think rationally if the father was good. Now it's upon the son to carry the father's mantle. He needs to carry that torch and make sure he's the shepherd of the family. But what I mean, the shepherd of the family, is that he is the leader of that family after his father has passed. So he needs to be equipped and knowledgeable enough to know how to advise the females of his family. You know how to assist them in vetting maybe a suitable man, or knows how to assist his mother in vetting another suitable candidate for her marriage. And I know this might come as a shock value to a lot of people, but this is part of the leadership role of a man. this is what a man's called to do. That's first of his value in the home. Well, then we're going to talk about the value out of the home. This is value in the home, leadership of his flock, the shepherd to his flock. He's the leader of that, making sure everything is safe and sound for them. So yeah, if his sister grows up to the age where she fancies someone, she needs to be able to communicate and converse with him, the father or the son, and say, oh, dad, this is so and so, I like him. And it's not part of the quality of a male father to shun her off. She is free to make her choice and have preferences. Your role, or the role of the father, is to say, okay, so this is your choice, right? Let's have a look at it. Having a look at the choice and decision she's made. And from a rational standpoint, because you will find most times in a home, and again, I'll say this, I don't want people coming at me, in a home, you find that the matriarchy is absolute in a home. But the father can't even decide rationally, because the mother immediately creeps in with an abundance or overflow of emotions. Where, oh no, you can't be with a certain individual because of his race. Or you can't be with said individual because of his background. Or you can't be with said individual because top race, ethnicity. You can't be with certain individual because of his tribe. You can't be with certain individual because of his religious belief, right? And all of those, I'm not saying they're invalid reasons, but they're emotional based reasons. And this is where a father needs to step in and bring rationale to the discussion, bring rational thinking to the table. So when you discard or refuse your daughters from being with said partners, you make sure it's on a rational basis, on good bar, right? When you've explained the pros and cons of being with certain individuals rationally, of course, without any form of discrimination or quote unquote racism, etc. And then she would then see from your perspective, or when you vet the partner and then you see, oh, well, he's actually a good individual she can be with, and you facilitate that. But most times not the case. Most times you see the mother creeps in from an emotional standpoint, and no, this can't work, that can't work, that can't work. Not in my book, and for us Africans is over my dead body, right? So that cannot work. You can't build a society or community based on that. So that's why it's critical and important for the men to reclaim their masculinity and reclaim their leadership role. Right. That's within the home. Now, the next point is men claiming their responsibility. Outside of the home.
also one of the reasons to it, which is women desiring imagining a lifestyle. Right? There's other reasons to it. Right? But those are one that's one primary reason why certain men get divorced. The fathers more certain than the fathers. Due to financial circumstances. Back in the hunter-gatherer's days, you weren't really financed as such because So the men will go out and obviously bring out a deer or a gazelle, whatever it is they was there, so a rabbit. Now there's means of earning, financial earning. And men need to take it upon themselves to get out of their comfort zones. Get out of their comfort zones. So to be able to say, okay, what are my earning potentials of the market right now? What are my earning potentials of the market right now? I used to hunt the rabbits. Don't worry, we're still within this example. I'm giving up the rabbits, but I used to hunt to get a rabbit. Okay, that's fair. I can perfect my hunting skills and go from maybe just using a knife to using a bow and arrow where I can hit targets from far and get bigger targets. So targets that might be too risky for me to approach, but I can hit them from far and get a bigger target. So in this modern day and age, that essentially means, okay, let's take a scenario. I'm a kitchen plumber. I'm young, dumb, stupid, probably smoking a few dollars. I wash dishes for a living. I'm not one of them.
needs to contribute to society. So he needs to ensure that he raises the upon good moral conduct, good character, strong and beautiful etiquette, so that they contribute to the society at large, so that they benefit the society and not just take from it, so that they benefit the society at large. Right? Go further into that, but that's his greatest contribution as a family, it's his greatest contribution to society. Now, his additional work that he can do is by his craftsmanship. He's a trainer, he's a specialist, craftsman, builds houses, cards, etc., etc., develop apps, developer. So all of these things, those are additional things that can bring benefit to a society. Right? So having a purpose, it's important. Having a purpose is massively, it's very important. Having a purpose is very important. Because a man without a purpose is a man at loss. Risk and a danger to society. Now, that has been said. The woman that he has, the wife, needs to understand that her greatest value is added to the whole. Being a helpmate to her husband. Being a helpmate to her husband. To help him achieve his purpose. A lot of people are going to come at me for saying this. Oh, you're saying women shouldn't have their own stuff together. No, that's not what I'm saying. I'm saying her purpose needs to be in alignment with her husband's purpose. That's how they both contribute to society as a whole. So their purpose needs to be aligned. Because if their purpose is not aligned, whatever that union they formed will fracture. That union they formed will fracture. Cease to be. Okay? And that is one of the particular reasons why today it is so important. Because women have been sold this delusional perception that they are hunters. Solely focused on getting it back until it's too late and they realize, oh shoot, oh snap, I should have thought about stuff that happened. I should have thought about the regrets that happened. Now it's too late. Past pregnancy. I'm past my prime. No longer that attractive. So, men need to go back to taking the masculinity, taking that ownership. And I don't want to hear people in the comment section going on about toxic masculinity, toxic that. No, there's no such thing as toxic masculinity. Just masculinity. Just masculinity. Okay? And of course, that needs to be done within a set of parameters. Other men holding other men accountable. Men driving good.
women knowing that to be married or for a man to actually commit to you, that is in fact honor and respect. A man does not respect you if he flies you out to have sex with you. A man does not respect you if he drives to yours or drives to his. Way in which he actually honors and respects you is if and when he understands that I need to marry her. But we're going to go into this discussion of marriage and if most women today are going to go into that discussion in another episode of the show. That is one critical thing that's fundamental that people need to understand. That a man that commits to a woman needs to be honest and respect her. A man that just does a fling here and there with you does not respect you at all. I don't care where he flies you out or how many holidays he takes you to. Okay? He's just the next in line. Taking his turn and move on. His time's up. Right. Now, from a religious perspective, for those that are religious, as a man, so from a religious perspective, as a man, you need to be an earner. You need to be an earner. And I would even argue that that is part of worship. To be an earner. To be an earner for your family. Because you find so many people who are devoutly religious, where yes, they want to marry, but they don't particularly have anything going on for themselves. But what I mean by that is some might not have a job, some might not have a craft, some might not have a trade, but they're very
Oh.